This is a code walkthrough for the example file PersonPhase10.java. In this file, we've added the final set of updates to our Person class in the form of various types of utility methods. And the first three that we added were several derived data accessors. So let me scroll down here a little bit towards the end. This is after the equals method, by the way. And here are our three derived data accessors: getAge, getIQ, and getBMI. And these are going to be calculated quantities. They're calculated based upon other more core instance variables. For example, for the age, we simply use our utilities method to calculate it from the instance variable for birth date. For the IQ, we calculate it based on the age plus a starting value of 100. And for the BMI, we simply calculate it as weight divided by height squared. Now, in all three cases, notice that these are accessors only. We don't have mutators for these because these are derived quantities. They're calculated from the core instance variables. And notice that none of them require any types of inputs. All of the data they need are already contained internally to this class. So for example, we don't need to input or declare the height and weight. We have these available as instance variables as we do the birth date and these methods here. For example, this getAge calls this one, which in turn calls the one in our utils method. So these all calculate their respective data types. And if you'll notice in our display methods, going back up to our print, we've added these to our print display. There's getAge, getIQ, and getBMI. So our print contains our core six instance variables plus these other three derived quantities. And we've just made a design decision not to add them to our to string, although I suppose we could have, preferring to leave these for just the six instance variables. Just a design decision, nothing more. The next thing we've added, going back down toward the bottom of the file, are a couple of utility methods for eating and exercising. And these are just some made-up relations. There are probably more things that a person would really do, but we're just assuming a person is going to eat and exercise. And we've got these made-up relations that say, for eating, for every 1,000 calories we ingest, we're going to increase the weight by 0.1 kilograms. And for exercising, we're going to arbitrarily assume that for each hour of exercise, we decrease the weight by 0.1 kilogram, as we see in these two relations. So we provide a number of calories, and the instance variable for weight gets changed. We provide a number of hours of exercise, and the weight changes in response to that. Again, these are purely made-up relations. You could substitute something more realistic, but this is just to get the point across. So these are things that our person can quote unquote do. Finally, the last utility method we've added is this update method. And this is simply a bundling of all six of our individual prompting mutators for our instance variables. We pass in an input mode flag, false is for scanner, true is for JOption pane, and we individually call the prompting mutators for each of our six instance variables. So this is a nice way of updating an object in one simple instruction. Okay, now that we've seen this code that's been added, let's see how this is going to get tested. So let's take a look at the code which tests these added utility methods. So let's scroll down to our main, and let's see. Here is the test code that we've added. So we'd like to run through this without having to run through all of the preceding test code, which we've added incrementally and already seen execute. So let's start by trying to compile this file, and we find that we can't. If you were to load up these example files, this PersonPhase10 or any of these other snapshot versions, for example, you'll find that it won't compile. And the reason for that is that the file is saved with the name of the intended class name person. So what we need to do here is we need to save this snapshot to the intended class name of person.java. So we'll do that right now, and I'm going to save over the existing version. And so now we're trying to run the class person.java, which should compile, and it looks like it does. So let me show you one trick with a debugger here. I want to focus attention on the stuff that we've added and leave alone the things that we've already seen execute. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, as usual, I'm going to set a breakpoint on main, and I'm going to hit the debug icon. But then what I'm going to do is I'm going to scroll down here to the point that I'm really interested in, and I'm going to put my cursor there, and then I'm going to click on this icon, which is run to cursor for selected thread, and it's going to go screaming through this test code. Now this is a step where it's expecting some user input, and I'm going to set an object up in some known state. So let's say John Doe, born on, how about the 4th of July, for year 2000, just to make the age really easy. And let's say they're male, and I can put in a lowercase m because it's going to standardize that to an uppercase due to our gender mutator checking. Let's say a height of 2 meters and a weight of 90 kilograms. And we go screaming through. And now we're at the point where we're really interested. So these are all the local variables that our main method has created to this point. And we're going to be interested in this P2 variable because this is the one that's going to get changed by our utility methods. So here's the current state of our object. All the values that we set are there. And we're going to print this out. And this is indeed the object that we set up. And notice that we've got the 3 derived data accessors added to our print output, age of 15, IQ of 115, and a BMI calculated from the height and the weight. So we know that that's working now. Great, that's our starting point. So in this next step, we're going to ingest 1,000 calories, and I'm going to step into that. So this is the object we're operating on, this P2 object. And I'm going to click on this bent arrow and step into that method. And now we are inside the eat method. And obviously, 1,000 calories is not going to trip that check. So we're going to update the weight. And here, we're inside the eat method. And we're actually operating, remember we said there was the keyword this, which referred to the current object under consideration. So this is the current object that we're operating upon, and we're going to update the weight by, what did we say, 1,000 calories, so 0.1 kilos. So if we execute this, notice that this changed, and then when we return to our main method and we expand the P2 object, the weight has changed. And then we will print the state after making that change. And notice that the weight has changed, but if you were paying attention, the BMI has gone up slightly as well. It was 22.5 previously. Now it's gone up slightly because the weight's gone up to 22.53. So the derived data accessor seems to be updating upon demand as needed. Great. So now let's exercise. Let's put in 2 hours of exercise. And again, we'll step into that method. And now we're in the exercise method. And we're exercising for 2 hours, so that check is not going to fail. So now our weight is going to decrease by 0.2 kilograms. So watch this value here as I step forward. And it goes down to 89.9. This is the numerical representation error we've talked about previously. This is why we have the 2-decimal format specifier for the height and the weight and the BMI. But now we'll return that value. And this is the P2 value that we're updating. and the weight has gone down, and we will print this out, and we see that the weight has gone down and looks like the BMI has gone down as well, from 22.53 to 22.47. So every time we print out our object, it's going to make a call to those derived data accessors and get current values for age, IQ, and BMI. So I'll scroll down a little bit, and this is the test code for checking out the output, or rather the update method. So what we're going to do here is we're going to print out a label, and notice that in this test code we've got lots of white space to make this readable, and we've got blank lines to kind of separate our output. This is just something you should do. And what we're going to do here is we're going to create a brand new P6 object, and it's going to have all default values, unknown, unknown, 00, and whatever the default date is, 11/5/2015 as I record this. Then we're going to call the update method using the false input, so scanner mode, and this one statement is going to issue me all the prompts to update all of the instance variables for this P6 object. So if I move forward here, it's prompting me for all the inputs. Let's say Joe Smith, and the debugger has taken me back to here, and it's prompting me for a birth date. I'm going to use my birth date of 7/18, and I'm going to step forward here. Let's say 2005. And again, I'm jumping back and forth between person and utils here. Where's my next prompt? M. And the height, let's say 2 meters. And the weight, let's say 99 kilos. Okay, so I've gone through all those prompting mutators, and I'm going to return to my main method test code. Here's my P6 object, and if we look at this, we can see that it's been updated with all our values, but we might not be using the debugger, so we still want to print that out. And if we do that, we'll see that all of the values that we prompted for have been reflected in the updated object. So all of these prompts came from this one update statement. So that's a nice thing you can do in your programs. Just set up a default person and turn right around and update all the values. Okay, so that concludes this demonstration of the last set of changes, adding utility methods and derived data accessors to our person class.